You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Now let's go to part two of the Alamo. In this part, we need to appreciate, and what's important to understand about the empresario and the settlers, the Anglo settlers that are going to move in, is the whole question of slavery. But the significance of the empresario movement is that while they are given some great terms for settling, they must be supporting the Mexican government in the elimination of native resistance movements. Because how else are they going to get their lands if they don't eliminate the native populations that are on those lands? So that's very significant, because Anglo immigrants are going to be used as a buffer against the native resistance so as to allow Mexican settlement. And that is the strategy that the central government of Mexico is going to pursue in Texas. And it's going to backfire on them, especially with regards to the issues of slavery. So when we take a look at the Alamo Part Two, well, what can we learn from this? This is the key. What can we learn from all of this experience, especially with regards to Central Mexico and the North? Well, it is important for us to become familiar with Mexico's major characters and events. These events are very important to appreciate because it shares with us the extent of political intrigue that continues to this day in Mexico. Mexico, the Mexican government, the centralization of power, the federalist system in Mexico, its notion of states' rights, the intense cleavages between the states' rights versus federal rights. This is the same process that conflict that the United States had to face with regards to compromising on slavery. States' rights, how much does the federal government have in terms of its power to impose its will on states? It's the same way in Mexico. But I want to emphasize the degree of confusion that pervaded Mexico simply because the Mexican North was a part of a strategy by the United States to expand westward. The United States is moving westward, and the United States is eyeing Mexican land. So what is significant for us in Chicano history, what we can learn from this, is to realize how the northern communities in Texas, in New Mexico, in Sonora, Arizona, and in California were divorced from the events that were occurring in central Mexico. This is the key. And what is significant from all of this, and what we can learn from all of this, is that we must recognize that the United States is plotting to take Mexican land. The United States is plotting to take Mexico and take Mexican lands. So this is what we can learn from all of these experiences. Now, what's going to happen in Mexico is the postponing of rights for the people of color, because when Vice President Bustamante succeeds in plotting against Guerrero, and remember, Guerrero is the black man that freed Mexico. Vicente Guerrero, he is ousted from office through armed insurrection. And when Guerrero is ousted, the Yorkinos are suppressed. Freedom of the press is abolished for those who criticize the government. The legislative assembly and the judiciary are badgered into acquiescence, and corruption reached new heights. Guerrero is going to be captured, and he will be executed. And again, how dare he liberate black people, liberate Africans, and emphasize mestizo rights. And so there is a conservative reaction to advancing the rights of people of color. So when we take a look at the leaders of the independence movement, the leaders of the independence movement are going to die before the firing squad. Miguel Hidalgo, José María Morelos, Iturbide, Vicente Guerrero. The only one that escaped death was Guadalupe Victoria. So traitor became the word to identify the leadership. Death was the supreme penalty. This is the foundation of Mexican politics. Let's appreciate that, okay? Now, what is important to understand is that with Bustamante ousting Guerrero, this is the second time a conservative vice president led an armed revolt against a liberal president within a period of 5 years. We come to this particular man named López de Santa Anna. Antonio López de Santa Anna is important to appreciate. He is a national hero. His character is very significant for us to understand. He will see the dismantling of the Mexican state and the transference of territory over to the United States several times. Once conservatives are back in power since the overthrow of Iturbide, conniving begins. National, state, and local governments are going to be plagued by civil disorder and corruption. Despite the abolition of the caste system and slavery, poverty, malnutrition, and illiteracy remained, and there is still the controversy in Texas with regards to slavery and Anglos moving into Texas and not respecting the Mexican Constitution. So in 1832, Santa Anna will come in to overthrow the Bustamante dictatorship, which is totally corrupt. He will win the presidential election of 1833, but Santa Anna has no use for political intrigue. He will leave the vice president, Valentin Gomez Farias, to run the country as he vacationed in his Veracruz fiefdom, known as Manga de Clavo, of which I provide for you a picture there. It is now a museum, but it is his vacation home. What is important to understand is that there's going to be another overthrow of a government in this brief 10-year period. First 15 years of Mexican independence. Gomez Farias immediately, as he comes into power, reduced the size of the military. He abolished the courts. Then he attacked the church by secularizing education, eliminating the tithe, and confiscating the funds and property of the Franciscan missions in California. The church, the army, and the conservative establishment called for the overthrow of the government, and Santa Anna will come to lead the conservatives and overthrow Gomez Farias, of whom he had put into power. So Santa Anna conveniently abandons his liberal past, and he will institute what is known as the Constitution of 1836. And the Constitution of 1836 will introduce what is known as the Siete Leyes. He abolishes the Federal Republic with a centralized state. He extends the presidential term, his presidential term, from 4 years to 8 years. All existing states are going to be transformed into military departments whose leaders were handpicked by him. Only those with high annual incomes could hold high political office. Numerous liberal politicians throughout Mexico will lead revolts against him. And Texas will be the most serious of revolts. So let's take a look at, again, this dictatorship. This dictatorship is very important because it's used as a means by which to teach children in Texas, in the United States, that eventually what the Alamo was all about was that they were fighting this vicious tyrant. But in 1835, the Mexican citizens of Texas are going to join with Anglos to rebel against the government of Mexico. Let's appreciate a particular man. His name is Sam Houston. Sam Houston was handpicked by Andrew Jackson in the 1830s, and actually in 1831. He was an alcoholic, a corrupt politician. Jackson wanted him out. Jackson sends him over to Texas to begin to create a controversy over the slave question. Sam Houston arrives in Texas, and he will denounce his Mexican citizenship, especially once López de Santa Anna implements the Siete Leyes. One of the things about Sam Houston is Sam Houston will run away from the tragedy at the Alamo. He will be drunk while the Alamo is being fought, and as fate will have it, once he gets out of his stupor, he will capture Santa Anna without breaches, as Santa Anna is going to celebrate the Mexican victory at Goliad, which he was caught off guard. Houston's victory at the Alamo is important. Houston's victory is significant. It's going to be known as the Battle of San Jacinto of April 21st, 1836. Let's appreciate something about the Alamo. Let's summarize the significance of the Alamo to Texas independence and the resulting U.S. war. Let's understand something about Texas independence, because in order to attract market activity to its northern frontier, again, Mexico opened its border. It allowed American immigrants to come into Texas. They came in waves to take advantage of the cheap land that was made available. The lax policies provided opportunities to people who had no interest in honoring the Mexican Constitution, much less becoming citizens of the new nation. So Mexico stopped its immigration policy, yet it did not provide sufficient funds to create an effective border patrol, because Americans, border or no border, were coming to occupy the land. This can be seen in the career and the life of Sam Houston. These illegal aliens then protested against Mexican rule, especially when slavery was abolished by the central government and the central government threatened to end slavery in Texas. And so the cry was, remember the Alamo. How does one want to remember the Alamo? Land, borders, slavery. That's what it's all the questions in territory. The Alamo erupted over those issues. Texas is going to declare its independence. And you have to recognize that there are Mexicanos, along with Anglos, who want this independence because they were frustrated that the central government was ignoring them. They had problems with the Comanches and the Apaches because it's Comanche and Apache territory, and the Comanche and the Apache are well known, have effective military units, especially the Comanche. And the historical record reveals that when Texas does declare its independence, it reveals that Texans had no interest in nationhood. The nationhood, Sam Houston immediately is going to send a message to President Van Buren that here is Texas, you're welcome to annex it as a state. Yet the historical record, the historical record reveals that Texas is going to be, as an independent nation, is going to have a very shaky existence. The nation is going to be funded by Southern slave interests. In its nine-year existence, Texas will live as an independent nation for 9 years, at least in their minds. Mexico will never acknowledge Texas' independence. And so Texas was desperately waiting for a U.S. administration that was willing to annex it. Martin Van Buren's presidency, when Sam Houston gave Martin Van Buren Texas, refused to or backed off from annexing Texas simply because this would be bad politics in terms of the world. Great Britain and France are watching. Mexico is telling the United States that this Alamo is their filibustering expedition. The United States is backing off, but the United States does one thing. It acknowledges Texas' independence. And by acknowledging Texas' independence, it gives legitimacy to something that was totally illegitimate. So Texas, in its nine-year existence, is desperately awaiting a U.S. administration willing to annex it. And those administrations will arrive in the 1840s. So let's go to a film clip that helps us appreciate Texas' independence.
By the early 1800s, Americans were moving west, driven by the belief in a God-given right to expand across the continent.
This vision of conquest was tied to visions of liberty and democracy. It was a providential mission. It was a Protestant mission. The problem, however, was that the lands that America wanted to occupy, in their imaginations, they were empty, but in reality, they were not. They were full of indigenous peoples of one sort or another, and in various parts of the country, they were full of Spaniards and their descendants.
Having pushed the native population west, the United States now stretched across Illinois to the frontier and down through Louisiana to the border with Mexico. The first Anglo settlers to cross the border ventured into the Mexican state of Texas, Texas, in 1821, invited by the government of Mexico.
Mexico needs to populate the area, so it agrees that anyone can come into Mexico who wants to settle there as long as they're Catholic and they pledge allegiance to the Mexican government.
The Comanches and the Apaches are basically in control. And as a matter of fact, there were several Spanish settlements that were abandoned as the Comanches in particular become more powerful. So the Mexican government wants to create these buffer zones with these Anglo-American colonists.
300 families, most from the American South, were led into Texas by Stephen Austin, a young businessman originally from Virginia.
Men like Stephen Austin are interested in transforming Texas from what they believe to be a wilderness into the next great cotton-growing part of the United States. But they understand that they have to work with Mexican authorities, they have to work with Mexican law, they have to work with Tejano partners in developing Texas.
A lot of the settlers of Texas at this time are coming out of the American South. They're imagining at least part of Texas as being a slaveholding society. They are never without these sentiments of the special superiority that inheres in the Anglo-Saxon race.
Once they start to get critical mass, they're not necessarily ready to accept Mexican government, and they start to find fault with the demands that Mexicans are making of them in order to be accepted in Texas society.
Mexican Texans, Tejanos, were also chafing under the rule of Mexico City, 900 miles away. Prominent among them was Juan Seguin, a third-generation Tejano whose family traced its roots in San Antonio to the earliest settlements in 1712.
Juan Seguin, very early on in the 1830s, already is starting to identify himself as someone else other than a Mexicano. As a Tejano, as a member of an independent republic. He has a conflicted identity. I mean, he calls himself John Seguin.
Seguin's father, Erasmo, San Antonio's postmaster, had personally conducted Stephen Austin across the Texas border in 1821.
Erasmo and Juan Seguin see Anglo-American settlement in Texas as important to the development of this frontier, outlying part of Mexico that isn't able to get the resources from Mexico City to properly develop the region. The Tejanos felt that government, which left decisions in their own hands, was vital to the progress of Texas. And Anglo-Americans, who had grown up with the tradition of strong personal rights, also wanted a strong local government.
When in 1834, Mexico's new president Antonio López Santa Anna dissolved the Congress to rule all Mexico with an iron hand, Texans and Tejanos united in opposition. In the fall of 1835, they rose in open rebellion. Santa Anna led an army of thousands across the Rio Grande to put down the revolt.
It's funny how I have to remind my students that, you know, they think sometimes that Santa Anna invaded the United States. And I have to disabuse them of that, saying, well, wait a minute, no. Santa Anna was marching into what was still Mexico.
On the 23rd of February, 1836, Santa Anna took possession of the city of San Antonio. 200 Texans fell back to an old Spanish mission called El Alamo. Among them, renowned frontiersman David Crockett of Tennessee, Jim Bowie of Kentucky, and Lieutenant Colonel William Travis of Alabama. There were also Tejanos at El Alamo, men with names like Badillo, Esparza, Navas, and Juan Seguin. Santa Anna laid siege to El Alamo. On the 25th of February, Seguin was sent behind enemy lines to gather reinforcements. At dawn on March 6th, day 13 of the siege, Santa Anna's forces breached the El Alamo defenses. Later that day, Juan Seguin headed back to El Alamo. Seguin listened in vain for the signal gunshot that was to be fired every 15 minutes, as long as the fort held. All the defenders at El Alamo, 189 men, had been killed. Seguin was left to bury their ashes.
Travis, Bowie, Crockett, are our brothers, whose valor places them in the rank of my heroes.
To the cry of Remember the Alamo, Seguin gathered a company of Tejanos and joined General Sam Houston's Army of the Republic of Texas at the Battle of San Jacinto. The Mexican army was taken by surprise. The decisive battle of the Texas Revolution lasted all of 18 minutes. Santa Anna surrendered, handing over Texas to Houston's Army of the Republic of Texas. Juan Seguin was named military commander of West Texas, elected senator of the new republic, and later mayor of San Antonio. But the survivor of El Alamo would soon find himself torn between his allegiance to the Republic of Texas and his loyalty to his own people.
You have an influx of Anglo newcomers, and what they remember is their countrymen being slaughtered by Santa Anna. So reprisals are taken against all Mexicans, including those who fought on the side of the Anglo settlers.
People are being randomly murdered simply for being Mexican. They're being pushed off their land by squatters who are trying to lay claim to these lands.
They're taking cattle, they're taking horses. It's a rough time.
Day and night, my countrymen ran to me for protection. Could I leave them defenseless, exposed to the assaults of foreigners who treated them worse than brutes?
These are landowners. These are Mexican elite members coming to Juan Seguin and asking him for protection from the aggressions of these newcomers. Juan Seguin is powerless to do that.
He's trying to uphold the law, and these brigands, if you will, are refusing to abide by the law. In fact, they threatened him personally. The people who just arrived see the people who have been here for a long time as the outsiders.
A conspiracy was organized to ruin me. Every party of volunteers en route to San Antonio declared that they wanted to kill Juan Seguin.
His Anglo allies will sell him out. They will not protect him when he needed protection. He has to give up the mayoral position in San Antonio.
On the 30th of April, a friend sent me word that a company was coming down the river burning ranchos on their way. Unable any longer to suffer the persecution of ungrateful Americans, I had to leave Texas, abandon all for which I had fought, to become a wanderer.
Juan Seguin fled to Mexico in 1842. In the 20 years since his father led 300 families into Texas, the line that would divide Latinos and Anglos had been drawn. In the Mexican province of California, the secularization of the missions had transformed the landscape. The vast mission lands now owned by a few hundred California families. And much like the Tejanos, in the years to come, the Californios would struggle to hold on to their land. For Mariano Guadalupe.
Okay, we went a little bit into a film clip on California, but let's understand Texas independence. Let me just summarize again. Mexican citizens of Texas are going to rebel with the Americans. A classic example is this man named Juan Seguin. We need to appreciate Juan Seguin in this picture here. General Sam Houston is going to renounce his Mexican citizenship. He will not be at the tragedy at the Alamo. He's going to be drunk, hiding out near a place that eventually is going to be called Houston. But nonetheless, Santa Anna was very arrogant, especially after his annihilation of people in the Alamo and his annihilation of people at Goliad. In Goliad, he is going to have no quarters, and he's going to eliminate all opposition. But he's going to be celebrating the Mexican victory. He assumes that that's the end of the fight, and so he celebrates. And what's going to happen is that he will get caught off guard. He's going to be without his pants, without his breeches. He's going to have to put on the uniform of a private. And here he is, the president of Mexico, the leader of the Mexican army, in the uniform of a private because he was caught off guard. He was celebrated. Houston's victory happened in, 12 minutes? Just like that, because everybody was drunk. This is going to be known as the Battle of San Jacinto, April 21st, 1836. Houston, like as I shared with you, will immediately send message to President Van Buren to annex Texas as a state. again, Sam Houston is a great hero of Texas, along with all of those who died in the Alamo, at least the Anglos who died in the Alamo. Juan Seguin. The tragedy of Juan Seguin is that, of course, he relied on Anglo support, and the Anglos never came through for him. This is usually what happens to Mexicanos who attempt to trust and put faith in non-Mexican citizens. The Alamo, what's going to happen is, in Mexico is 2 years after the Alamo, the French are going to invade Mexico in 1838 over debt claims, and they're going to bombard Veracruz. Let's appreciate something about Mexican political history between 1833 to 1855. It's going to be characterized by chaos, by anarchy. Between May 1833 and August 1855, just to share with you, the presidency is going to change hands 36 times, with the average term for a president being about 7.5 months. Again, the political intrigue of the center is significant here. That's the Alamo. That's the end of part two of the Alamo.